Good question. We kind of talked about it in our Chevy meeting last week amongst the other drivers, and there was really no solution that came to the forefront. The only one that I really had was to reduce the fuel cell size in half to just create more opportunities of coming to pit road to just break it up more. But then you put your pit crew and the guys on pit road in more danger. You know, you put twice as much emphasis on doing all of that. But, you know, that when you come to pit road, it kind of breaks up the field for a little while, right? Like, you take about 10 laps to kind of get it all sorted back in and get going again. Well, we go, 33 laps on fuel? If you go 15 or 16 and it takes 10 to bunch everybody back up, well, now you're getting ready to pit again. So you're not going to sit there and save. You're going to be going all out as much as you can and making sure that you're not breaking, that you're not fuel saving in order to do the leapfrog strategy. I mean, a couple guys said, no, you'd still do the same thing. I don't know that you would.
Is it a problem? Is problem the right word, or is it just
an evolution?
I believe it is.
I believe it's a problem. The start of the race last week for the Daytona 500, we're all sitting around there running half throttle, not passing, just riding in a line. And I felt disgraceful myself, being a race car driver, wanting to go fast and lead laps and win the Daytona 500. And that was our strategy that we had to employ at the start of the race because everybody was doing it. I mean, the pace, when you're running wide open and you're in a draft, your pace is probably a 46.30. We were running 49.80s, almost 50-second lap times. It was pathetic. I was like, how slow are we going to go? You know? And so I felt bad for the fans. I was like, this is not good for them. It's not what I wanted to be doing. But when you kind of get in that situation, you can't – I don't know what you do. The third lane could have developed. It was so early in the race. Nobody wants to develop a third lane. Like, we're riding. It's a 500-mile race. Don't blow everything up in the first stage, right? So, but somebody could have just pulled out into the outside lane and literally just ran to the front and done whatever the heck they wanted to do. So I was surprised nobody did that.
And one last thing, and thank you, is when you say disgraceful, I mean, it's – there are a lot of races where it's a 500-mile race. You've got to, you know, like you say, you can't lose it immediately. You've got to take your time to kind of build up. It's still, the cars are too wide. It still, I guess, kind of looks good visually in a sense, maybe for a fan perspective. If you don't have a stopwatch, can you really tell?
But there's no passing. Like, okay. People want to see passing. The fans are all about, hey, we want to see racing. We want to see passing. That's not racing, you know. It's riding. And, yeah, back in the days, sure, you had 500, 600-mile races where you needed to ride for a while. But at least you're still trying to – Coke 600, for instance, right? It's a long damn race. But you're at least still trying to pass the guy in front of you and get position as the day goes on. You're not just going to ride in 15th for the first 100 laps and be like, yeah, cool, I'm good with riding 15th right now. No, you want to get further up the ladder and run – with speed and your talent and your car's ability and everything else. And doing what we did last week, you might as well pull the cars out of the parking lot and run rental cars around.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Jordan Bianchi, The Athletic. Has there been any conversations within your team of how you approach these first two races in terms of car managing the cars and equipment and everything? Of, you know, you leave Daytona, you're down a car now. You come to Atlanta, you could very easily be down a car, and how that you guys approach that, especially with the West Coast swing coming up?
Yeah, our Atlanta car was the car that we raced in the 500. So, you know, everything kind of got pushed up a week. So the 500 car that we crashed, it went back to the shop, and it'll be probably I think we're on a 5-week cycle. So whatever the hell the fifth race is will probably be where that one goes. So this week's car was slated to be our Vegas car. And so it just kind of moves everything up. The cars are all the same, so there's really not much differences that you have. I mean, you're talking maybe 100 thou on a body part that you can push or pull or whatever that you can get through the Hawkeye, but it's not a lot.
And going back to last week, when you had the slow pits or the issue with the tire on the, mm-hmm. on the pit stop, Richard comes on the radio and kind of tells everybody to get their head out of their butt, right? I don't know if you've had a car owner say that before over the radio, like, you know, going back.
Well, that wasn't on my channel, so no, I didn't hear it.
Oh, but. He did. Oh, he okay. Well, he told the team to
in not so direct words to get their heads out of their butt.
Sometimes he needs to tell me that.
But when you have a car owner like that, and this is not slamming Joe or anything, but like when you have a car owner like that who's really involved, what's that like? Like who's fiery and passionate, maybe kind of takes it off of your shoulders so you don't have to say that stuff.
Well, I mean, that's kind of what I answered earlier to Bob's question was Richard is very involved and wants, you know, any situation to get better. If we're not winning every single race out of the year, then how did we lose that one race? You know what I mean? What can we do to make it better? And that's a racer's mentality. That's what we all try to strive for and try to be better at. So, you know, it's tough sometimes when you've got the human element. I mean, we all make mistakes. I made tons of them last year, and you know, my crew stuck behind me and you know, was passionate that I was their driver and wanted to go to the next week and figure out how to win the next one, you know. So I know where Richard's coming from, and I appreciate that. And the emphasis that he puts on greatness and wanting to be better is what we all strive for.
Let's go to Charles.
Charles Odom with the Associated Press. It once was an annual tradition to hear drivers come in here and lobby for one more year with the old battered track surface. And now that the resurfacing came with the reconfiguration, I'm wondering if the warm and fuzzies have all gone. Even William Byron with two wins in the reconfiguration just said, I don't know if I'd want to come here every week. But what has been gained? What has been lost? Where does this new new track configuration rank with you?
Yeah. Any form of restrictor plate pack style racing is not high on my list, you know. So I would say, obviously, as much as the surface deteriorated, there comes a point where something has to be done, and they went through it. I just don't understand or appreciate why we added the banking and the stuff that they did here in the reconfiguration, although it's the same wall outside wall space. You know, would I have much rather seen them just repave what we had? Probably, because you would know then that at least when it deteriorates some and gets, it can get back to the old Atlanta ways. If this deteriorates here, I mean, it's going to be fast. It's going to be damn fast sliding around, you know, like 10 miles an hour faster through the corner sliding around than what the old track would have been comparatively equal time frame on asphalt. So, I mean, we're racers, though, as I said before, right? We all want to go fast and do what we can to be the fastest ones out there. So it's not that you're scared of that. It's just the hits are harder.
Let's go to Jonathan.
Jonathan Viel, the racing expert. Later today, you're going to make your first drafting track start in the lower series since 2015. What was behind the decision to run the truck race here?
Well, watching the truck races here last year, it doesn't necessarily fall in line or orchestrate itself as a Daytona or Talladega style race. It is different. So I kind of took that into consideration that you can make some moves by yourself. Yes, you're in a line, you're drafting, you're trying to hold on to the draft and all that sort of stuff, but it did seem like there was some times in which, you know, handling kind of came into play and making some moves kind of come into play and whatnot. But it's definitely not like a Kansas where you can be the leader and run away and go hide, you know. So wasn't my first choice. Definitely wouldn't have been at all my choice. But thankful for the opportunity that Spire and Group 1001 gave to me to be able to come out here and run the five truck races that I'm allowed to do. And this was the fifth one that was available on the list that I could do. So I didn't have much pick. It's tough with the pick with all the regulations and things that I have with NASCAR and all that sort of stuff, with the triple truck challenge races, the playoff races. I don't do speedway races, so my pick of the litter was, I think, literally 8 or 9 races that I could do. So it gets small.
Yeah. And there's been a lot of discussion about recently, you know, the truck series, the current state of it. What are your thoughts on just the current state of the truck series?
You know, You could talk about the current state of NASCAR. I feel like the current state of NASCAR is healthy, is strong. You look at the Cup Series and the top, and having all the things that are kind of happening behind the scenes with big team owners kind of coming in and being a part of all of that, and it just trickles down, you know. So being able to get a new TV deal and all that sort of stuff with NASCAR and the TV networks, you know, we're all grateful and thankful for that and the hard work that was put in behind the scenes for that. But, you know, it trickles down to the Xfinity Series. It trickles down to the Truck Series. So would I say that there are 500 Fortune 500 companies that are all out here participating in our sport? No, there's not, you know. So the sponsorship landscape is absolutely the toughest landscape in our sport, but I don't know that that's any different than what it was in the high time, in the mid-90s to the mid-2000s. I mean, I think you still saw cars that were in the back of the field that were underfunded or had a struggle sometime being able to find big name sponsors to be able to get them to the track or to get them a better footing within the series to withstand and have some strength to their company.
Go ahead, Jacob.
Jacob Seelman, Race Face Digital. Kind of just expanding on the Truck Series theme just a bit. In racing with Spire this weekend, obviously a lot, you know, it's assets that you were familiar with when it was KBM. You'll be the first to say, I know that Jeff and TJ aren't newbies at this. So what kinds of things are you in your consultant and driving role looking for to help them improve on?
Well, I mean, just yesterday, you know, whatever the heck was going on, we unloaded and the truck was wandering super, super bad. It was really darty and all that stuff. So I do wish we had a, you know, 20-minute practice just to be able to get out there and roll around. And you can feel that stuff. Like, we could have fixed a lot of things in my truck just based off of me going out and making some single lap runs in practice, not even drafting. I didn't even need to get in the draft to feel that. So, but we kind of just worked on some air pressure stuff to try to help that. It helped a little bit. But there's definitely still some things that I'd like to make adjustments on, but you can't. You're locked in. So I don't like that fact of not being able to better your stuff. You won't see the changes that I feel like you need to make until they come back here the next time, you know? So, but is what it is.
So it is more on the driving side than as much on the business side?
Yeah, no, I don't necessarily feel like I need to tell them how to run their business. I can tell them all the things that we did that made us what we were, you know, but there's a lot of different people there as well too now. So, you know, although it is KBM assets and everything else, it's now Spire. And, you know, Brian Patty's the only crew chief that's there. I had Bono for a little while. Bono and I worked together. We won some races together, so he's there. Congrats to those guys. They won last week, which is cool in our stuff. That's the first Daytona win for KBM equipment since I think I won there back in 13, something. I don't even know when it was. Had to be before 15. My legs are telling me that.